So welcome to this new ecotoxicomic webinar. So today we are pleased to welcome Betty Chaumet, who's coming from Irstea, Bordeaux.
Good morning, everyone. So today I will present you a part of my thesis work about biofilm transfer and distribution mechanisms in the biofilm linked with toxic effects associated. So I did my thesis at Irstea in Bordeaux in France with Swazik Morin and Nicolas. So, firstly, pesticides have many uses like domestic, viticultural, veterinarian, and agricultural. And my thesis was involved in the Fitograph project, which aims to make the link between pesticide uses and their presence in the environment. So, today we know that pesticides are widely spread in the aquatic environment, which are final receptacles of any contamination. So there are many ways for pesticides to join the aquatic compartment. For example, after they use it, they can join the atmospheric compartment by volatilization. Then they can join the terrestrial compartment after a rainy event, for example, and then join the aquatic compartment after leaching or lixiviation process. And this is in this context that my thesis section in order to study the water biofilm pesticide transfer, and in this case, biofilm. So the main aim of my thesis was to make the link between pesticide bioaccumulation and the toxic effect in order to assess pesticide effect, pesticide risk, sorry, for aquatic organisms such as biofilm. So biofilms are composed of heterotrophic and autotrophic microorganisms like microalgae, algae, fungi, and bacteria. And all these microorganisms are embedded in an EPS matrix, which are extracellular polysaccharidic substances. And this matrix is more particularly composed of DNA, nucleic acid, unique substances, polysaccharides, or proteins. So biofilms are the base of the trophic chain and are able to integrate and react quickly to the contamination. That's why they are considered as good bioindicators. So as I said before, biofilms are composed of autotrophic organisms like microalgae, which have a photosynthetic activity. So the aim of my thesis was to study pesticide-biofilm interaction, and all along my thesis, I used the Diuron as a molecule model, which is a photosynthesis inhibitor herbicide. So in order to study this interaction, and more particularly to study the pesticide distribution in the biofilm, I decided to split the biofilm into two fractions. The first one is represented here in green, which is composed of the microorganisms and the tightly bound EPS. And the second one, which is represented here in gray, which is composed of diffusible EPS. So all along this presentation, I will name these two fractions respectively, the TEPSM fraction and the DEPS fraction. Also, it exists a boundary layer, which is always in interaction between the water column and the biofilm. And this boundary layer has a resistance of mass transfer, so in this case, a resistance of pesticide transfer into the biofilm. So there are many ways to study biofilm-pesticide interaction, and today I will present you some of them. For example, the accumulation in function of the time, which can be characterized by a first order kinetic. So a first order kinetic can be calculated thanks to this equation and is characterized by two stages, as we can see here on this graph, where you have the contaminant concentration in the biofilm in function of the time. So firstly, we have a step of accumulation and then a step of equilibrium. That means that when pesticides are present in the water column, they can be accumulated by the biofilm with an uptake kinetic constant, which is represented here by the slope. Then biofilm can release this contaminant in the water, with an elimination kinetic constant, and after some time, we can reach an equilibrium, which is represented here by the plateau. And thanks to that, we will be able to calculate the diuron concentration in the biofilm at the equilibrium. And then to join the exposure factor to this effect, it's possible to use a toxicodynamic approach. That means that we are going to assess the toxic effect in function of the time. Then another exposure factor, which is the exposure concentration. So this interaction can be studied thanks to the sorption isotherms. So to study pesticide bioaccumulation in the biofilm, it exists many different models, but today I will present you two of them. And the first one is the linear regression. As we can see here on this graph, so we have the contaminant concentration in the biofilm in function of the contaminant concentration in the water. And this model takes into account an unlimited number of sorption sites in the biofilm. And the second one is the long wheel model. And as you can see here on this equation, this model takes into account the maximum diuron concentration in the biofilm. That means that in the biofilm, we have a limited number of sorption sites. And then to make the link with the toxic effect, we can use, for example, the Hill equation in order to obtain the EC50. So the effective concentration at 50%, and also the Emax model. So this predictive model will allow us to calculate the effect in function of the maximal effect, the diuron concentration in the water, and the EC50. And this model takes into account the possible the nonlinear relationship between the dose and the effect. So, we have seen that pesticides are widely spread on aquatic environment and can be accumulated by the biofilm, but not systematically. And also, we know that the toxic effect are not always proportional to the pesticide bioaccumulation. So today, we know that we are able to quantify pesticides in aquatic environment and also to measure the toxic effect on biofilm, but we don't know what happened between these two stages. That's why one of the objectives of my thesis was to characterize the mechanisms involved between these two stages. Another objective was to study the pesticide distribution in the biofilm in order to know if they will be accumulated in the microorganisms, or in the EPS matrix, or in both fractions, and in parallel to make the link with the toxic effect. And finally, the objective was to determine if environmental factors can modify these mechanisms. So, in the first time, in order to study pesticide distribution in the biofilm, I had to separate, to extract the EPS from the whole biofilm. So today it exists different methods like the cation exchange resin, but this kind of resin can interact with pesticide and present a competition phenomenon between the biofilm and the resin. That is why I developed a physical extraction method in order to separate the DEPS fraction from the TEPSM fraction. Then, in order to respond to the different problematic, I used a mechanistic approach in order to characterize diuron kinetic and distribution in the biofilm and its isotherm. And in parallel, I also studied the toxic effect of this pesticide. So this mechanism's description will allow us to establish a predictive model in order to calculate the diuron concentration in the water from the bioaccumulation values. And finally, I studied the variability of the biological response in function of different environmental factor. But today I will present you the flow velocity influence. Now I will present you the method I used during my thesis. So firstly, in order to develop the extraction method, I use a mature biofilm. So for that, I put glass slide on the pond of gasinous esters close to Bordeaux during 1 month. Then I took off this glass slide and I put them on the channels where I can I could control the nutrient input, the flow velocity, and of course the contaminant inputs. And these channels were on the thermoregulated room where I can control the light intensity and the temperature. So to develop this extraction method, I had to test different protocols, and the more relevant was I was 30 minutes of agitation for the biofilm, which was crushed and put in the beaker. Then 2 times 10 seconds of sonication, and finally a centrifugation during 20 minutes at 5,000 RPM. Then I was able to extract the DEPS fraction from the supernatant and the TPSM fraction from the pellet. So I realized then different analyses, like the total organic carbon. I measure also the total organic carbon in the biofilm because this analyze informs us about biofilm composition and biomass. So this analysis was realized on the total fraction thanks to a TOC meter. Also, I quantify the pesticide in the TEPSM fraction and in the total fraction. So for that, samples were filtrated in a bushel. Then we have a step of lyophilization in order to obtain the biomass. And then pesticides were extracted from the solid matrix thanks to an ASE. And in order to avoid any matrix effect, samples were purified by SPE. And finally, biofilm samples and water samples were analyzed thanks to the UPL system. And to measure the toxic impact, we use a picobomb for the total on the total fraction in order to obtain the photosynthesis inhibition. So I will start with the first study I performed about the flow velocity influence on toxicokinetics and toxicodynamic approach. So depending on their places in the water course, biofilm are not exposed to the same flow velocity. And we can suppose that a high flow velocity, for example, can modify the biofilm shape and consequently its resistance to the mass transfer. So its resistance to the pesticide transfer into the biofilm. We could also suppose that a high flow velocity could impact the pesticide distribution and pesticide accumulation and consequently the toxic impact associated. So in this study, I used the mechanistic approach to determine the kinetic and the distribution of the pesticide in the biofilm, and also I assessed the toxic impact. So for that, biofilm were exposed in channels and to two different flow conditions. The first one that I will name low flow, which is kinetic, and the second one, which I will name flow, with a flow velocity of 2 centimeters per second. Then the biofilm was exposed to 0, 5, and 50 micrograms per liter of diuron. And so the samples were collected at T0, so before the experiment. And then after 1, 2, 5, 15, 30 minutes, and 2 hours of exposure. So here you have the first result for the biomass analysis. So we have the total organic carbon in microgram of carbon in gram per gram of dry weight in function of the different flow conditions. So here in blue you have the results for the low flow condition and red for the flow condition. And now I will just present you the results at T0, so before the experiment. And here we can see that the results are similar between the two flow conditions, which is not the case after 2 hours of exposition for any treatment. So we can see that under low flow condition, we have an increase of total organic carbon and a decrease of concentration under a flow condition, which means that we have a loss of organic matter in the flow condition. And so here we can suppose to an abrasion phenomenon. So now you have the results for the toxicokinetic approach. So there is the Diuron concentration in the biofilm in microgram per gram per square centimeters in function of the time. So the point represents the experimental data, and the cube are the representation of the first order kinetic hyperfilm with the same experimental data. The results in blue are the results for the total fraction, and the results in green are the results for the TEPSM fraction. So I will start to present you the results for the low flow condition only. And here we can see that the accumulation is not proportional to the concentration of exposure. Then we can observe that the accumulation is really quick, because we can see that the equilibrium is reached within 40 minutes. And then we can see that we have different accumulations depending on the fraction considered. And now the results for the flow condition. Here we can see that the results for the TEPSM fraction are similar between the two flow conditions, which is not the case for the total fraction. So here we can suppose that the difference between these two accumulations is related to the DEPS fraction. So now we have the results for the toxicokinetic approach. So you have the photosynthesis inhibition in percentage of control in function of the type. So here we can see that we have a treatment effect, but we don't have an impact of the flow velocity. Because as we can see on the top of the slide, biofilm exposed to 5 micrograms per liter of diuron have a photosynthesis inhibition around 11%. And for the biofilm exposed to the highest concentration, we have a photosynthesis inhibition around 40%. This kind of results is pretty unexpected, because before we have seen that we have a higher accumulation under a low flow condition than under flow condition. So now to summarize the experiment, we have seen that in the total fraction we have a quick accumulation. And also we have seen that the photosynthesis inhibition was simultaneous to the accumulation. Now about the TEPSM fraction, we have seen that the accumulation was similar between the two flow conditions, which was not the case in the total fraction. So as we have seen at the beginning, we have an abrasion phenomenon, so maybe under flow conditions, so maybe a decrease of the thickness of the whole biofilm. And about the photosynthesis inhibition, we have seen that we have a similar effect, but so we can suppose that the diuron accumulated in the TEPS fraction maybe is not bioavailable for the microorganisms under 2 hours of exposure. So now I will present you a study about the determination of diuron sorption isotherm in biofilms. So as we have seen, we know that biofilm has a heterogeneous composition, which imply different kinetic of accumulation and so different mechanisms of sorption. So in the study, I also use a mechanistic approach in order to determine the diuron isotherm in the biofilm, in order to know how diuron will be accumulated in the biofilm and what is the associated biological response. So for that, I expose the biofilm and channels during 2 hours, so after the equilibrium at 20 degrees. At 8, increase diuron concentration, so 0, 1, 5, 10, 25, 50, 75, and 500 micrograms per liter of diuron. So here are the results for the bioaccumulation. So you have the diuron concentration in the biofilm in microgram per gram, in function of the diuron concentration in the water in microgram per liter. So here the points represent the experimental data. So you can see that we have three different stages. Firstly, we have an increase of the diuron concentration in the biofilm. Then we have a saturation phase, and again an increase of the concentration. So I use the two models I present you previously. So in orange, this is the representation of the linear regression model with a regression coefficient of 0.96. And the red cube is the representation of the Longmuir model with a regression coefficient of 0.97. And here you have the associated constant, so the maximal diuron concentration in the biofilms, which is around 18,000 micrograms per gram. So at this stage, we are not able to say which model is the most appropriated to characterize the diuron bioaccumulation in the biofilm, because the regression coefficients are really close to one to another. So now there are the results for the toxicity. So you have the photosynthesis inhibition in percentage of control in function of the diuron concentration in the water in microgram per liter. So the point represents the experimental data, and the cube is the representation of the Emax model. So as you can see here, this model fits pretty well our data. So as you can see here, the toxic impact is continuous, so that means that we have an absorption by the cell, which is a continuous phenomenon. Then, in order to test the Emax model and to decide which model between the Longmuir model and the linear regression is the most appropriate to characterize the diuron accumulation in the biofilm, I decided to reuse the Emax model, but now instead to use the diuron concentration in the water, I use the diuron concentration in the biofilm calculated with the two previous models. So here you have the results. So in orange, you have the toxic impact predicted from the linear regression model. So as you can see here, the results are really underestimated in comparison with the experimental data, which is not the case for the Longmuir model, which fits pretty well the experimental data. So here we can say that the Longmuir model is the most appropriated to characterize diuron bioaccumulation in the biofilm, and as you have seen before, this model takes into account a limited number of absorption sites in the biofilm. So that means that diuron bioaccumulation in the biofilm is not linear. Now, to summarize the experiment, we have seen that along a diuron concentration in the water gradient, we have seen that the toxic impact was continuous. So we know that we have a diuron absorption by the cell continuously, but this was not the case for the accumulation, just because we have seen that we have a saturation phenomenon. So now we know that we have the diuron diffusion through the EPS matrix, mostly. Secondly, we have an absorption by the cell, But in parallel, we also have an absorption by the EPS matrix, which can explain the saturation phenomenon. Another explanation could be related to the heterotrophic compartments like bacteria, because these microorganisms are able to accumulate the diuron, but we cannot measure the toxic impact by photosynthesis measurements. So thanks to this experiment, we have established a predictive model. So thanks to the Langmuir model, we can now reuse the diuron concentration in the biofilm to calculate the diuron concentration in the water. And finally, we could calculate the toxic impact. So at the end, maybe this model could be used on the field. So now let's move to the discussion. So previously, we have seen that the Langmuir model was adapted to characterize diuron accumulation in the biofilm. So that is why I decided to reuse all the bioaccumulation data I obtained along my thesis and to re-inject them in the Langmuir model in order to test the robustness of this model and to highlight the possible improvements. So in the curve in black is the Langmuir model representation established previously, and the curve in red is the Langmuir model established with all the data I obtained with a regression coefficient of 0.71. So here with this decrease, we can see that we have a loss of some stability, but also an increase of robustness, because the first model was established with a database with a 28 value, and the second one was established with 228 value. So also we can see that the two cubes have the same shape, and also the constants associated are really similar. But this decrease means that we have a variability. So now we are going to search the origin of this variability. So here I plot all the data I obtained along my thesis. So here you have a zoom from 0 to 70 micrograms per liter of diuron. But today we will focus on the flow velocity experiment data, represented here in blue. So I calculate the average, and we will also focus only on the flow condition, because it was carried out under the same experimental condition as the isotherm sorption study, with a flow velocity of 2 cm/s. So in orange here, we have the results, the average of the results obtained at the equilibrium, and in pink, you have the results obtained before the equilibrium. So here we can see that we have a small variability, which is due to the time exposure. So now we know that it's possible to fix some limitation to this model, like to use this model after the equilibrium, so after around 1 hour of exposure. So which represents really few constraints, and also we are seeing that we have no major influence on the Langmuir model. So that's why we can say that this model is robust and could be, for example, used for field study. And now some outlooks. So before to use this model for field study, we have to improve it. And for example, we can take into account other factors like the mixture effect. In fact, pesticides are never present alone in aquatic environment, but are present in mixture. So we can suppose that the mixture of pesticide could modify the sorption mechanisms and imply some competition phenomenon. But until now, we don't know the impact of this competition phenomenon on the Langmuir model. So I don't have the answer but I can give you some key points to answer to that. So my thesis was involved in the Phytocode project, where I carry out a study on the Marciac town, which has a high viticultural activity. So I will not present you the whole field study, but just one campaign I performed between May and June 2017. So here are just some results. During this campaign, we quantified 26 pesticides over 5 different sites. So as we can see, biofilm was able to accumulate different compounds from different nature, like for example, herbicide, metabolite, fungicide, or insecticide, and the Diuron. And we can suppose that we have a competition phenomenon because here, for the we have the pesticide concentration and the biofilm in microgram per gram. So for the highest pesticide bioaccumulation, we can see that this maximum concentration is far below the maximum capacity of the biofilm to accumulate there. So all these results bring new problematic about competition phenomenon. So it's possible now to adapt the model to the mixture effect. And for example, we could perform other experiments using a mixture of pesticides, like for example, 3 different herbicides which are photosynthesis inhibitor, like Diuron, which belongs to the family of substituted urea, such as the isoproterone. And also we could use the atrazine, which belongs to the family of the triazine. So after that, we could assess the bioaccumulation for each molecule and a mixture. And also we could determine the EC50 for each molecule in order to use the additive model. So this represents just the first step, because to validate the model, we should use a much more complex mixture to test it. And so now to conclude, during my thesis, I was able to highlight the different mechanisms, like a quick accumulation in the biofilm. We also have seen that the bioaccumulation was not linear in the biofilm, and we have seen that the toxic impact was simultaneous to the accumulation. And thanks to these results, I was able to establish a predictive model. Also, I could determine the Diuron distribution in the biofilm. So we are seeing that we have an absorption on the EPS matrix. And also we are seeing that the Diuron accumulated on this matrix was not bioavailable for microorganisms. And we also are seeing that we have a continuous absorption by the cell. And finally, we could highlight the impact of flow velocity on the Diuron bioaccumulation. So I would like to thank you for your attention.